right? You told them that.
Have you ever heard the term fuckhead idiot?
Yeah, every day I hear it from my audience.
Yeah, well, well, that's who I was dealing with at Capitol Records.
Wow.
You know, gangsters and fuckhead idiots. They didn't pay attention to anything. They didn't know anything, and they didn't do anything.
When Rockin' Me becomes your second number one single, are you amazed or are you like, I knew it, right?
Well, he did me a favor. Paul was a really great guitarist and a great writer.
Yeah.
And he was blind.
Yes.
And Albert Grossman was his manager, and there's another fuckhead idiot for you, you know, who did a very bad thing to Janis Joplin and to Paul. And Paul had...
What did he do that was so bad?
Well, in Janis's case, he took her out of rehab for heroin and put her on the road doing 60 cities like the next week. And she was drinking a quart of gin a day and
that's not good.
Was dead 2 months later.
Mm-hmm.
He should have been put in jail.
Well,
yeah.
Yeah.
Howard.
I mean, I don't know any of this.
Howard.
You know way more than I'll ever know.
Listen,
you know all the inside
you
stuff.
Know when,
I don't
like,
know that.
When people are making money off of you and, you know, you're dying and they're going, that's okay, honey, you know, we'll get, you're doing fine. Isn't it great? She's off heroin, you know.
You saw a lot of that go down, right? I mean,
yeah,
you never got into drugs, right? You never were a big drug
guy.
You
know, a little pot and a little LSD. And what could go wrong, you know.
Right.
But, you know, they came in and they booked us all. And we all felt like, you know, the guys in L.A. were gangsters.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't want them in our scene. There was a real thing between the two cities. And we went down and played that show. And
you had a local following at that point in San Francisco.
Yeah. We played the Fillmore 120 times.
Wow. And that's before
seriously,
any
120
radio.
Times. Really, like 120 different times we were at the Fillmore for 2-3 nights.
And
no
record contract. Just doing your thing. Isn't that amazing that they didn't discover you? When a band starts playing 120 nights and sells it out, don't you think that the record company should have recognized you?
Yeah, but you know what they did was that, you know, you're assuming record companies are intelligent. You
right,
know, like
right.
that they knew what they were doing. We were like so underground and, you know, we were this scummy, dirty place, this old Fillmore Auditorium, this psychedelic dungeon.
Yeah.
You know, there were drugs. I mean, blah, 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 blah. And it was Annette Funicello and Frankie Avalon and Pat Boone. You
right.
know,
those were the times.
In the business.
Yeah.
You know,
right.
those were our artists, man. And when they finally did come to San Francisco, it was a feeding frenzy. So when they did show up, I had 14 record companies trying to sign me, you know, from gangsters to the, you know, CBS.
Was it, like, so unbelievable? Was that the point where you went, oh, my God, all my struggle, you know?
I had a friend who's a prosecuting attorney in San Francisco.
Perfect.
Dick Hodge. And I went to him and I said, these guys are all gangsters. They're going to try and steal my music.
Yep.
They're going to do this. They're going to do that. I have to have 100% artistic control. I have to own my publishing and my songwriting.
Wow.
And I need enough money to make 5 albums. No cut because, you know, I'm going to have to develop. So
right. You make a good point. You needed a 5-album deal because there's no guarantee you're going to put out an album. You've never really done studio recording.
I had everything was, you know, homemade.
Had you written all?
So he comes up to do his interview and I just said, Cameron, you know, I really don't want to do this interview with you. I just, you know, it's not that I don't like you. It's just I don't think you're the right guy.
Wow.
He goes back to Rolling Stone and he hands out an office memo that goes around to everybody at the office. And he goes, Steve Miller's the biggest asshole I ever met in my life. He was rude to his wife. He was rude to everybody in the room. He thought this was going to be a cover story. He did this. He did that. And Jan calls up and goes, Steve, let me read you what Cameron wrote. He sent this to everybody. He said, I got a great idea. Why don't we print this and your rebuttal?
Oh, yeah, you'd love
and,
that.
And that's, you know, this is 1976. So what are you doing tonight, you know? And he says, oh, I'm reading your speech. I said, oh, great. I said, well, I can't wait to get the fuck out of here.
Right.
What I said to him.
Yeah.
You know, and I didn't know who he was.
Right.
I didn't have a clue who this guy was.
So you didn't have anything against him. You were just confused.
You know, if we had been introduced, I'm sure we would have gotten along because we like the same kind of music. And, you know, they're working musicians and stuff. The whole thing was a setup to, you know, they got exploited, man. I felt like they really hurt themselves. And Jan is just like, hey, let's print it. And they immediately got a call saying, look what the Black Keys said about you. Let's do a, you know, you can answer it. And
right.
I just said, fuck you guys.
That's not.
It's going to get better. I'm going to get these guys. They're going to be sorry that they treated all these people this way. And it's going to go on, and it's going to get better. And the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame's actually going to go to Cleveland.
Right.
And the museum's actually going to mean something. And the funding they raise is actually going to be used for music education before I'm done.
What are you planning?
Oh, I can't tell you.
What? Are you planning something?
I'm planning to keep it in the news. And I'm planning to investigate them. And
really?
I'm planning to, I've already got all their public documents, and I want to see where they're spending the money. I want to see who's being paid. I want to check it all out.
Well, that's amazing.
And basically, I want the public to get what they want. And, you know, here's the bottom line in all of this. You know, this elitism, you know, like, hey, man, Steve Miller should be in, but not Bob Skaggs.
Right.
Or, you know, Freddie King's a great blues player, but, you know, T-Bone Walker, whatever. All that kind of hair splitting and stuff is so petty, and they should really, really include everybody and enlarge the gene pool, because their gene pool's really inbred now. They are so inbred, they don't even know what's going on.
Who is they, anyway? I mean, who are the people who choose Steve Miller
Cheap Trick? Just changed
Jan Winter's
son. And, you know, apparently Jan and his family and his personal friends, you know, and basically it was started as a tax write-off for Ahmet Erdogan and Jan Winter and Alan Grubman and those people. And they, you know, it was just like, it'd be like you and me saying, hey, let's start the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Get the lawyers over here. What can we do?
Well,
let's do that.
You know what I've learned from this interview, Steve?
Yeah.
Remind me never to give you an award, because you'll destroy me. I was going to present you today with an award.
You know, this is the only award that I've complained about. You know,
yeah.
And I've been to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I've seen it. It's a place where they sell postcards, you know. It's like, and listen, you know, you're a knucklehead.
Years.
You know, you started as a knucklehead, and you made your way through this whole world, Ben, and you're the last knucklehead standing. And,
that's it.
And I'm really, really honored to have been on your show. And I remember the very first show I was on.
Gosh.
They said, Howard Stern, it's the drive time show. We're going to go over. You're going to do an interview. Come on. You know, it's Capitol Records kind of
right.
thing.
At NBC,
you know, dragged me over to the station, and I thought, well, I was going to be talking to you for 20 minutes.
Yeah.
I remember it perfectly. I walked in, and was going, hey, we got Steve Miller here. Hey, oh, just a minute, Steve, there's a phone call from a fan, and it was Richard Nixon who wanted to know the cords to Abracadabra, and I was on the street in 4 seconds.
Right.